Welcome to the top 3 reactions of kids facing life sentences. These aren't your average bedtime stories. From twisted confessions to courtroom jaw-droppers, these cases are a roller coaster of youth, crime, and the haunting consequences that follow. Buckle up. You won't believe the turns these stories take. Nicholas Lindsay. Our first case takes us to St. Petersburg, Florida. On February 21, 2011, 45-year-old police officer David Crawford responded to a call about a suspicious person near Tropicana Field late in the night. The caller had reported a man holding a brick in his backyard who had jumped the fence, which raised concerns of a potential burglary. Upon arrival, Officer Crawford located the person and left his vehicle. At 10:37 p.m., fellow officer Donald J. Ziegler observed and reported an exchange of gunfire. Crawford was found near his cruiser, having been shot multiple times at close range while reaching for a notepad. The incident triggered a large-scale response, with more than 200 officers from various agencies across Tampa Bay joining an extensive manhunt for the suspect. The manhunt concluded on the night of February 22, 2011, as police, acting on community tips, arrested 16-year-old Nicholas Lindsay. Lindsay's initial accounts were quite suspicious and conflicting with each other. But after a while and some pressure from his family, he later confessed to details that aligned with the evidence already discovered by the police.
I did not do it. I'm telling you, I did not do it.
Who did it?
It's gonna be okay, son.
Lindsay eventually broke down and admitted to discarding the firearm in a nearby creek.
Well, good evening, Linda. Detectives are telling us that Nick Lindsay bought a .380 handgun about a week before this all happened, but he has not told detectives who he bought that gun from. They did look for that gun today at Brooker Creek, but they didn't find it.
Subsequently, he was booked into the Pinellas Juvenile Assessment Center. Nicholas Lindsay received his first life sentence last year, but then the U.S. Supreme Court declared it unconstitutional to sentence a juvenile to life in prison without parole without a hearing. In light of this ruling, Lindsay was given a second chance.
Lindsay is sitting here in the Pinellas County Jail right now, where he'll wait to find out what his resentencing will be. The judge today allowing himself some extra time to review the case and go over all of the information that was presented today. But I can tell you, if you talk to the prosecutor or any law enforcement officer, they'll tell you killing a cop is enough to keep you behind bars forever.
And he received a life sentence again.
The court has significant doubts about the defendant's potential for rehabilitation.
But this time his reaction was different.
Justice was served, and I'm glad it's over, and it just kind of proves to me that he's an animal as he sat there smiling.
It sure is tough to get your hopes up just for them to be shattered again. But grinning at a life sentence is certainly not usual. But to some, it shows that Lindsay does not feel remorse anymore for what happened back in 2011. Our next case is, again, from Florida. Aiden Fucci. Tristan Bailey, one of 5 children of Stacy and Forrest Bailey, lived in Durban Crossing in northwest St. Johns County. She went to Patriot Oaks Academy, where she was also a cheerleader. The discovery of Tristan's body on Mother's Day, May 9, 2021, followed her family's report of her missing. The 13-year-old had suffered multiple stab and slash wounds. Aiden Sean Fucci, 14 at the time, also a student at Patriot Oaks and a neighbor of Bailey, was implicated in the crime. According to Fucci's girlfriend and other friends, he had a history of discussing violent acts, including a specific plan to abduct a random person into the woods and fatally strike them. Fucci was then arrested on a first-degree murder charge in connection with Tristan Bailey's death. On the night of Tristan Bailey's murder, Aiden Sean Fucci reportedly asked for her phone number, as stated in police reports. Subsequently, he convinced her to leave her house and meet at a friend's home. Surveillance footage from a nearby house captured 2 people, believed to be Fucci and Bailey, walking east on Saddlestone Drive, close to the location where her body was later discovered near the end of a retention pond. An hour and 45 minutes later, the same video captured Fucci returning alone, carrying his shoes. An autopsy conducted on Tristan revealed a harrowing 114 stab or cutting wounds about her head, neck, shoulders, arms, hands, and back. Of these injuries, at least 49 were identified as defensive wounds. In Fucci's arrest report, He initially confirmed being with Tristan Bailey at a friend's house and leaving together at approximately 1:10 a.m. on May 9, 2021. He claimed to have walked around for some time before reaching his Castledale court home at around 3:30 a.m. But during the investigation, an investigator realized that Fucci's account had inconsistencies with Fucci repeatedly changing his narrative. Eventually, Fucci admitted that he and Bailey had got into an argument, during which he pushed her to the ground, resulting in her striking her head. During the search for the missing Tristan Bailey, an investigator made a noteworthy discovery when coming across a Snapchat story from Fucci. The story showed Fucci in the backseat of a patrol car, taking a selfie and holding up a peace sign.
Having fun in a cop car.
Yep. Tristan.
What's up, guys?
Tristan, yep. If you walk out the damn, it's in a cop car, guys. Tripping, dude.
During the trial, Tristan's sister showed a jar of stones, each symbolizing a stab wound inflicted upon Tristan. With a heavy and haunting silence in the courtroom, she dropped each stone into the jar one by one, forcing the court to bear witness to the gravity of the violence Tristan Bailey went through.
This jar now holds 114 stones, one for each of the 114 stab wounds that my sister had to endure.
Just before the jury selection in February 2023, Aiden Sean Fucci changed his plea to guilty.
And Mr. Fucci just wanted to make a short statement.
I just want to say I plead not guilty. And I'm sorry for the Bailey family and my family.
On Friday, March 24th, the legal chapter reached its conclusion as Judge R. Lee Smith sentenced Aiden Sean Fucci to life in prison. Despite the heavy sentencing, Fucci showed no reaction and maintained a cold and unconcerned demeanor throughout the proceedings.
Mr. Fucci, having entered a plea of guilty to the crime of first-degree murder, I adjudicate you guilty of the premeditated first-degree murder of Tristan Bailey. I sentence you to life in prison. Because of your age, you are eligible for a review of the sentence in 25 years. I order the Department of Corrections to notify you when you are eligible to apply for your review hearing. Madam Clerk, if you will please impose the minimum fines and court costs. Mr. Fucci, you have 30 days to appeal the legality of this court's sentence. If you wish to appeal but cannot afford an attorney, one will be appointed for you. You will be taken back to the Duval County Jail and then transported into the Florida State Prison System. We are adjourned.
Dylan Shoemaker. Our last stop is New York. On March 19, 2013, in Springville, New York, something very disturbing happened. Dylan Shoemaker, a 16-year-old, was looking after his girlfriend Ashley Smith's two young sons while she worked at a restaurant. At the end of the night, one of the boys was discovered deceased. Shoemaker was subsequently arrested for causing the child's demise. Further investigation revealed that Shoemaker had severely beaten Austin, the older son who was almost 2 years old, which resulted in his tragic death. During the trial, Dylan Shoemaker admitted to hitting Austin. He claimed he hit him because Austin was crying and disturbing his baby brother. According to him, he placed a pillow on Austin's head and punched it in an attempt to silence the cries. In the courtroom, Dylan found himself tearfully apologizing to his 19-year-old girlfriend.
I didn't mean to kill Austin. Actually, I really didn't. I really think I did this. I didn't mean to hurt him.
But despite his tears and apologies, the jurors who convicted him of second-degree murder didn't buy his words. Addressing Shoemaker, who had recently turned 17, the judge asserted that at the age of 16, Shoemaker was aware of right from wrong.
I can't take back what was done. I wish I could. I would give my life for Austin. I loved him a lot.
He also labeled Dylan Shoemaker a manipulator and deceiver.
The record will show that you admitted on July 23rd, 2013, in a phone call to your mother from the holding center, you stated, and I got a quote from the court reporter, "I am a 16-year-old blonde. Probably all I have to do is cry in front of the jury, and they're going to feel sorry for me," end quote.
In the end, Shoemaker was handed down the maximum sentence of 25 years to life in prison.
It is a judgment of this court that upon your conviction for the crime of murder in the second degree, that you be sentenced to an indeterminate term of imprisonment, which will have a maximum of life. The court hereby imposes a minimum sentence of 25 years. The surcharge is $300, the crime victim's assistance fee is $25, and the $50 DNA data bank fee, all to be paid out of prison funds. We have 30 days within which to file a notice of appeal.
As of today, Dylan Shoemaker is 26 years old and has spent a total of 9 years in prison since his conviction in 2014. Currently serving the remaining portion of his sentence, he is located at the Clinton Correctional Facility in New York. That was it for today. If you found these cases as fascinating as we did, don't forget to hit that like button and subscribe for more content. We're always on the lookout for the next jaw-dropping narrative, so drop a comment below and let us know what kind of story you'd like us to unravel next. Until then, stay curious, and we'll catch you in the next chapter.